ready to go?
Ready. All right, so we are extremely happy to have Ernesto Lupercio from senior staff. So, Ernesto is an expert on topology and topology and multiple theory, but this subject is his new lab, and so he will enlighten it on it. I must say that we should be very grateful since he decided to give us his time under really very extreme circumstances when he was given 5 days to finish the paper. Otherwise, so, in any case, Ernesto, very glad to hear
you. Thank you so much. I'm honored to be here at the Institute. I'm a guy, of course, and it's so beautiful. And we are having such a great time already. We have many more interesting conversations. but this is one of my secret interests, you know. And of course, everything I'm going to say, well, today is really the work of many mathematicians. I mean, it's well-known material. In fact, these two lectures will be appropriate for undergraduate students. So don't feel offended if I say things that are very simple. But I hope it's fun, nevertheless. But again, my audience is meant to be extremely wide. Hello, everyone on YouTube. So this gives an opportunity to force yourself to record the lectures. So it's supposed to be extremely wide, so this is for everyone. And of course, everything in this field I learned from Nikita Kalinin and Misha Shkolnikov,
which we all were very happy to get here.
Yeah.
In fact, he was supportive.
Yeah, absolutely. And so they are fantastic. And we are together with one of my students that is doing all the heavy computer work. This subject is very amenable for computer calculation. We're writing this book, and today is kind of a report on the kind of the approach that we are taking into the writing of this book, into the subject. But of course, this goes to the subject of artificial life, as I mentioned. And so today it will be really about self-awareness criticality. And slowly I'll make my way into the models of artificial life. There are meant to be these things that you as I was telling the question is whether, I mean, we know, thanks to the game of life of Conway, that you can program a computer to have many of the features of life, of the qualitative statistical behavior of life. But the question that we ask ourselves is whether the computer can program itself to do this. And here the work of Dar, the previous work of Dar, and again many mathematicians. And in the book we quote hundreds and hundreds of references. Started this circle of ideas, but that's kind of the inspiration. Can we have a computer program itself to emulate life? Because of course, this is when you see this flower, this hummingbird, nobody kind of made it. It kind of made itself. So how does this happen? Is there a mathematical theory for things making themselves out of thin air? And this is what this field is about. But then today I will point out that it has this remarkable, surprising, to me, very surprising relation to algebraic geometry. And why should it be so? And we don't really understand it. But I will mention these relations. So I will start defining a model that programs itself to produce complexity, lifelike complexity. And it, that's what's called self-organized. Because physicists discovered this model in the late 80s. And when physicists discovered this model, it was the case that they knew that life behaved, physicists understood that life behaved very much like a phase transition in physics. By phase transition, I want you to think of the moment in which water is freezing. And this is modeled mathematically. And when you model mathematically this, you have all these mathematics that go about phase transitions. And in particular, you get all these statistical behavior, the statistical mechanics. And you get these statistical distributions that you don't usually get. They are extremely fat-tailed distributions, unlike Gaussians. And when you study probability and all these things, very often you have this law of big numbers, etc. And you are thinking of Gaussians all the time, and well-behaved, thin-tailed distributions. But then when you study phase transition in physics, you do your calculations with statistical mechanics, thermodynamics, this kind of thing, and then you get these fat-tailed distributions that are very counterintuitive. There is, for example, there is this one particular exponential distribution, so that suppose that you get to the bus station and you are waiting for it, and you just saw the bus and go. You know, right? So, oh my, you saw the bus, your intuition tells me, then the bus now will take a longer, chances are that my wait will be longer. Even if there's a lot of randomness in the distribution of lanes between the buses. But in these distributions that are so counterintuitive, you arrive to the bus station, the bus just left, or the bus left an hour ago, or there's people that have been waiting for 2 days for the bus. And the expected length of the wait is the same, either way. It doesn't matter what moment you arrive to. So this is totally counterintuitive. And this is the sort of distribution that you are getting in these phase transition physics. So you have that. And so physicists were trying to write down a model that would look like phase transition, but the pair back that led this effort wanted a model that programmed itself. He was not thinking like that. He was not thinking in terms of algorithms, now we do. But he wanted a physicist model that would exhibit phase transition criticality. But that unlike water freezing, where you have to program the water to freeze, you have to control the temperature, the pressure and the volume for the water to freeze. So this is called fine-tuning of the theory. You have to fine-tune the parameters of the theory for entering into the critical transition state. They wanted to make a model. And of course, if you can argue that these critical points typically in thermodynamics, it wants to go off the critical point. It wants to freeze, the water wants to be frozen or liquid. It doesn't want to be freezing. So it wants to go off the critical point. So instead. But in this model wants to go back to the phase transition. It just wants to be there. And it wants to be there by itself. You don't have to fine-tune parameters. So no fine-tuning of the parameters. The model just wants to get into the critical state, and then if you perturb it, it wants to go back to the critical state.
What are physical examples for such processes? Maybe something in astrophysics? Or
your brain is an example.
Sorry?
Your brain is an example. Living systems are like that. And this is very cosmic. They behave unlike any other physical system, but they exist, and they are there. So you have these physical systems, they are there, you know, these ecosystems, at various scales of behavior, various scales, spatially and otherwise. And they behave like this, you know, they seem to violate the second law of thermodynamics. Of course, we know the solution is obvious, they violate it locally, but they violate it. But they violate it locally, in time and in space. And so, physicists wanted to get such a model, and they tried hard. And then, of course, with equations it's hard, and then they got a cellular automaton. And this goes back to the study of life, von Neumann with Ulam invented cellular automatons to have artificial models of life. And so the physicist discovered a cellular automaton that behaves like this. And this was a big discovery. The paper became extremely famous in the 90s. It was the most quoted paper in all the decade of the 90s in all of physics. The paper where this model appeared by Perbach, Wiesenfeld, and other collaborators. And it's very simple too. It's surprisingly simple. So it also ties up with these stories of emergence, where very simple local behavior produces this astonishing global behavior. This is not unlike the Poincaré-Hopf theorem, where you have these little points here and there. You have these little numbers here and there, you know, this vector field, global vector field. But you just look at these points where it vanishes, these little numbers where it vanishes, the order of vanishing. And then you get the Euler characteristic of the whole space. You get this global topological invariant out of this simple local behavior. So it's not like that. You know, you have these very simple local rules of interaction. And you get this amazing global behavior. So this is the subject of today's talk. But again, I'm going to do this at the undergraduate level. So I'm going to describe the model that they define in this famous paper. And it's called the Sandberg model. And this is an extremely simplified toy model of self-organized criticality. It's a toy model, you have toy models in various fields of physics. This is a toy model, it's not meant to be a realistic model, it's just meant to capture qualitative behavior of self-organized criticality. In any case, we get Z2, and this is the points of linear coordinates inside two. But it's going to be very important for us not to consider not only the lattice, but actually the graph. And it's this graph, the one that we're going to consider, given by horizontal and vertical lines. And there is many graphs that I can put with vertices Z2. I could take a matrix and myself to Z and move this story. And I do not want to do that. This is highly non-invariant to transformations. It's this graph. And everything that I'm going to say depends on the structure of that graph inside the plane. So that graph I call gamma Z2. Just to call it something. That's that graph, not other graph. And of course, I'm going to be very interested in subgraphs of this graph. And just for the matter of illustration today, I'm going to take gamma n equals to gamma z2 intersection 0n squared. Just that rectangle graph that ends there, doesn't have the outside of that. Just that piece of graph. It's just that kind of thing. So graph structures. Very important. And now we're going to get the set of states. So this is a dynamical system we're going to describe. So it has discrete time, time goes like 0, 1, 2, 3, da, 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 da. It's just discrete time. It's a dynamical system. and the states are just functions. From the vertices to it's just numbers. You know, a state could be here 5, 3, 2, 1, 0, 7, etc. It's just a state. So these are like states, and the states evolve in time. So there are states, they evolve in time. So you are to think of ij as the number of grains of sand at I, comma j, and remember this is integer numbers. So in like a big, this is just like a matrix. I mean by a matrix, if this was a this graph, or a bigger matrix, but I could take a circle here rather than a rectangle, and then I would have this graph. It would be a pixelated version of the circle. It would be this graph. And this n is meant to be very large, or the radius of the circle is meant to be very large. This theory is not so exciting for small graphs. The graph is meant to be very, very complicated, very large at least. And then of course there is a clock, and I want to see what happens when time passes. What happens when time passes? What happens to state when time moves one tick at a time? And I'm going to erase this. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And what happens is that, well, we are here, and again, I look at the points that are bigger than 3. And why bigger than 3? Because I want them to be bigger than or equal than the valency of the vertex, the number of entries that come to the vertex. So that's 4, so bigger than or equal than 4. So I look at the points where the number is bigger than or equal to 4 and say these are the only points that are bigger than, and the other ones are not. Let's say this is 3, and this is 2, and this is 1, and this is 3, and this is 0. Let me go do this example. Etc. Everything else is 0. Subtract time, tic tac. Well, what do I do? How do I know this evolution? Well, it's not deterministic, this system. I take any point that is bigger than 3, any, with equal probability, I take any, and I topple it. So, if this is the vertex W, I call this the toppling of W, I don't know. What does it mean? It means, well, everything else is left the same. But here it's interesting. The same. But here, it becomes loses 4 grains of sand, so it becomes a 3. This becomes a 1. And 1 grain of sand disappears forever. Disappears forever. It falls off the table and disappears. And so, trick. Problem is, in something like this, then I get a new matrix. Problem is here, when it fires, it topples, then this becomes a 4, this becomes a 4, this is a 3, this is a 1, and now I have 2 more active points, 2 more unstable vertices. And then this is unstable. And this, of course, is stable. But it may not be stable forever. It could become unstable. And you keep going, And then it's conceivable that you go forever. You think, nah, probably not, because I'm losing some sand. But you don't know if you enter into a state that this puts lens to these fires into this and this into this and this into this and this into this. You get these waves where you go, does it finish? It doesn't finish. What's going on? Now imagine that you have this enormous gap. You have a lot of sand here and a lot of sand here. And then you start having these waves that move back and forth. You see what I mean? So what's going on? Who knows? But, and there's also this random aspect to the process, you know, where the filings are happening at all these points, but the order is not predetermined. So, and now, we are going to prove a remarkable theorem.
Sorry, may I ask a question?
Yes.
So you consider a process where you pick vertices and you couple them, and you repeat the process for different vertices, or
so
how do you pick the vertices? How do you pick the vertices?
At random. At random. If there is a point that is bigger than 3, it can be picked. And you pick any point that is bigger than 3. And you fire it, you double it. And then you look around, another bigger than 3. And then you fire it. And then you look around, another bigger than 3, unstable. You fire it. Another unstable, you fire it. And but people, points that were stable became unstable. Oh, you fire it. And then another unstable, you fire it. Another unstable, you fire it. You look, and the first one you see, doesn't matter which one, you fire it. There's this random aspect to the process. And so you fire, and you get this movie of something happening in this. You can think of these numbers as colors, and you can do it on the computer. And you see this movie, but you want the graph to be enormous. Otherwise you don't see the action. You want them to be small pixels of color. And then you see these waves moving back and forth, and solid waves and things. And it's very extremely complicated story. But there's only one rule, it's very simple. If it is bigger than 4, it can fire. And it will fire. You don't stop while there is an unstable. And you say that you reach a stable state if everything is less than equal to 3. And now you do nothing and you finished. And that's the final state of the dynamical system. If everything is less than or equal to 3. So yeah, the stability, total stability of a state is that it's less than equal to 3 everywhere. But as soon as one point is bigger than that, you gotta fire it. In what order? A random order. Yeah. Any other remark?
Can I ask you? Mm-hmm. I mean, anyway, you enforce the rule of direction only by 4.
There's 4 directions and before. Four grades fires simultaneously to the 4 neighbors.
Yeah, but I mean, other direction also possible, but...
No, it's about the graph. As I said, it's about the graph. It's about the graph, and this is the graph.
Right.
So it won't go diagonally, ever. It has to go along an edge of the graph.
I see. Well, I mean, yeah, I think it's good from there, but it really describes the sense by... how precisely this model describes the sense
five?
How precisely this model describes the behavior of sense?
Of real sense?
Yeah.
I don't know. Of course. Think about it. Say there is a 4 here and a million here.
Yeah.
Well, and you saw this point before you saw this one. Then you fire. It becomes a million one. This is very weird. I mean, how could it climb a million this one, you know? But it's not meant to be a realistic model of sand. It's not meant to be a realistic model of anything. It's just some cellular automaton. It's nothing else. In fact, nevertheless, experiments have been made on real sand. And while it does not describe the microscopic nature of sand, surprisingly, the macroscopic nature of sand, its statistical behavior, is described by this. And this is funny, because locally, obviously, it's nonsense. But when you have really a very, these are tiny pixels, now it doesn't look very so like sand. And that is interesting. But anyway, but it's only statistics. So the errors will be averaged out in the statistics and blah, blah, blah. But don't think of this as realistic. This is just a combinatorial cellular automaton, integral values, abstract nonsense. Okay. So that's the system. So we have time 0, time 1, and certain vertex 0, and certain vertex 1 in topos, time 2, and then certain vertex, maybe vertex 0, vertex 1, just to count, vertex n, minus 1, and then phi n, and now this is less than or equal to 3, and so it stops. Question. Does it always stop? Answer, yes. But more is true. Suppose that you start by the same phi 0, but now you chose another one. And then you get phi 1, but of course, I don't know. Let me call it something else. It's the same. It's the same. But I'm going to call it psi because it's another evolution. Exact same number of steps. It doesn't matter in what order you chose the vertices to get to the final state. This is surprising. Tells you there is something to this theory, maybe, you know. And then this is the reason why it's called the abelian sample. If it doesn't matter in what order, you topple the vertices. The final. So it's very easy to write an algorithm now on the computer. And if you don't know this theorem, see, you choose one at random, and then you choose another, and you're detecting points that are bigger than 4. Well, now you go left to right, up to bottom, and you just do it again, and then you just do it again, and then you just do it again. Now it's trivial to write an algorithm, and very fast, because matrix and these things and addition by one are very fast on a computer. So, this allows you to write a very fast algorithm. But it's still not so fast. You just have to go through the steps. Anyway, is the statement of the theorem sensible? And it's clear why it's non-obvious. And do you have the proof? Do you have a proof? Can you imagine how this proof would look like? Well, this can be proved by secondary school kids. It can be proved by very smart secondary school kids. And there is elementary proofs of this theorem. There's totally elementary proofs of this theorem. But then you have to be extremely smart. And I propose today to you today that we shan't be smart at all. We'll just prove the theorem, but not being smart, because.
Nice. Sydney, may I ask why
the people call abelian. What was the meaning of abelian?
Well, abelian means that the order of the vertices that you topple doesn't matter for the final state.
So, to express some kind of compatibility, we say abelian.
The what?
To express some kind of compatibility, we say abelian for this case.
Well, the order doesn't matter. Abelian just means that the order doesn't matter. That the order doesn't matter.
Yes, so this amounts to these finite graphs, and you said it doesn't matter whether you pick a rectangular one or a circular one.
In fact, for any finite graph, it doesn't even need to be on the plane or the square graph, can be any graph.
Any
graph. But it's going to have at least one sink. Here, I can think that the sink is here. What is a sink? And this is connected twice to the sink. This is once to the sink. This is once to the sink. A sink is where the sand disappears. And I have to add here one sink. At the corners twice, joined to the sink, and at the other end once, joined to the sink. And the sink is one very special vertex where the sink, where the sand disappears. And there could be more than one sink. In this case, one sink is enough. So the theorem says for any graph with at least one sink, this is 2. But 4 is not 4. 4 is not 4. It's the valency of the vertex. So whenever the number is bigger than the valency of the vertex, it can topple. The valency being the number of edges that come into the vertex.
So it will depend on the vertex in general?
Huh?
In general
it will depend on the vertex. In general, it will depend on the vertex.
I mean, you mean that this kind of setup can hold for other graphs, other than...
It's exactly true for any graph. Any graph. With at least one sink. But it doesn't matter. Because the problem is just as interesting for these graphs. So let's not think of other graphs. Let's not think of other graphs. Because the problem is just as interesting for this graph. Anyway, how do you prove this thing? Either you are a tremendously smart Olympiad level kid, and then you can prove it. Or you're not. And then you have to prove it without being smart. So, but there is proofs that don't require you to be smart. So let's do one such proof of this theorem that doesn't require you to be smart at all. And this is, of course, soon enough, if you're trying to prove this theorem, you will consider, so what do? You start just cumbersome. You start trying to prove the theorem, and you think of this point, you know. And you say, well, see, in this process above, I define a function, and also in this process below, I define a function that tells me at every vertex how many times that vertex was toppled, fired. So let's say this was fired m times, l times, k times, r times, s times. But now it's not the number of grains of sand at that location. It's the number of times that vertex fired, toppled. And so, this is called the toppling function. Toppling function. And this is f of ij. Is the number of times that vertex toppled in the whole process. Okay, and soon enough you'll get, obviously, to this quantity. Set an initial value of phi ij, and you want to know the final state the final state. Well, the final state is this. Because it received these many grains of sand from the neighbors, and it donated these many grains of sand to the neighbors. Okay, but we know what that quantity is called, you know? Because we're not high school kids, we do know that the Laplacian of F at ij is a number. That's an Laplacian. In fact, notice that if the Laplacian of the function was zero, then this would say that the value at the center of the square would be the average of the values in the circle. And that's what being harmonic means. So being harmonic, vanishing of this discrete Laplacian, means that the average, that the value of every point is the average of its four neighbors. So that's it. But that's the definition of the Laplacian. It's just, what is the Laplacian of a function? It's just, the value of the addition of the value of the four neighbors minus four times the value of the function. That's the definition of the Laplacian. So that's a Laplacian. And now we have a partial differential equation that solves this problem. Because clearly, if this has a toppling function, phi phi, and this has a toppling function, phi psi, that depends on the initial state, but it's the same statement. Different toppling functions that got you to the final solution. Well, then clearly, the difference is harmonic. This is pretty obvious. That's the one that's obvious. The difference is harmonic. Well, just write these for one of the processes, these for other processes, take the difference, and well, the difference has to be zero, so the difference has to be a harmonic function. So it is a harmonic function, so we have to understand this harmonic function. But now, it is a harmonic function, isn't it? So, this harmonic function has a maximum, this graph. It's a finite graph. So it has a maximum, vertex. And there's a point where it reaches its maximum. But at this point, it's a harmonic function. The value of the function at this point is the average of the values, the other four values. So if this value is k, and it's the maximum, all the other ones are less than or equal, but they average to k. They have to be k. There is no option. Because they average to k, and they are less than or equal than k. If one of them was smaller than k, could it be k, the average? So they have to be k. And because the graph is connected, the function is constant. And it has to be zero. It's got to be zero because there is a sink. There's a sink where the sand disappears. And so it's not possible that, well, think about it. This constant has to be zero. And then the final state is the same. Because the final state is this plus this. But this is the same plus this. Because these two Laplacians are the same. And you just add the Laplacian at the top of the function and you get the final state. Obviously, if you add the Laplacian at the top of the function, you get the final state. So the final state is the same. And now the number of toplings is the same because it's a constant function. The topling function is a constant function. How we finish? It's true. And we didn't have to use math. So the theory is true. And so the theory is about this partial differential equation. That is it. We have to find these harmonic functions to solve the problem.
Is this how they quoted in the paper?
In which paper?
In the original paper.
I don't think they care about this theorem in the original paper. I think this is a theorem of Dar, but I'm not sure. And probably Dar did prove it like this. I mean, he understood very well. He understood very well the things. So this is probably a physicist argument. By the way, it's a beautiful thing. And now, you know, you can topple in any order, you'll get to the same thing. In the same number, in the specified number of steps, that the number of steps give you a function called the toppling function, and that the Laplacian of that function plus the original function gives you the final state. The Laplacian of that function plus the original function gives you the final state. And you now know all those things. So, but there is more in this direction that you can prove, that is very beautiful. So let me say it. But now I'm very worried about time, I'm going so slowly. Well, how much time do I have?
Like 14, 15 minutes.
Okay, very well. I can do that. Of course, I will cover 10% of my first lecture, but that's okay. Okay, so we don't know. We know. Several, all this follows from what I just said. F is well defined from phi. So F is F. The initial state completely determines this function, whose Laplacian gives you the top, whose gives you the toppling function, whose Laplacian gives you this effect to run. So that's that. The second is that phi plus delta f is less than or equal to 3, of course. We know that is now. The third is that we can take the space of functions that satisfy that condition. Now it's just every function that satisfies that condition. And f of b is, and this proves also uniqueness. This proves uniqueness. Perhaps a better way to prove uniqueness. So if you take that space of function, the minimum in that space of functions is the one that solves the problem. Is the toppling function for the actual evolution of the sample. So also, you know, that if c is less than or equal to phi, then the relaxation locus of phi is contained in the relaxation locus of phi. The relaxation locus being the vertices that actually relax at some point in the process. At some point in the process, and this is also obvious from what we just said. And theorem is true. Theorem is true for general graphs. Graphs with at least one sink. And we need the sink because when there's this inductive process, where we know sand is going, and so the process ends Otherwise, it could just, you know, on a torus with nothing, minor graph on a torus, it could just go on and on.
Excuse me, how do you define relaxation?
Relaxation locus is a set of vertices that fire at least once in the process. The relaxation locus is the set of vertices that fire at least once. And the final state is unique, so we call it the relaxation of the initial state. We call it the relaxation of the initial state. This whole process is unique, the final state. So we call it the relaxation. Very well. So now, I'm horribly short in time, but I should show you, I should say a few things that I may or may not prove next time, and I may change my plan for the second lecture. You'll tell me. But let me say a few verbal things. Well, that's a nice thing, very nice. So, but again, what does this have to do with these self-organized critical systems? And it has to do the following with them. The situation is the following. Now imagine that I have this huge table, very large table, these tiny squares, that I put at the center of the table a trillion grains of sand and zero everywhere else. So I have trillions of sand at the center of the table, and I don't get it. So this is called delta 0, 0. 10 to the 9 states. So delta 0, 0 is a function that takes value 1 at 0, 0 and 0 everywhere. So we get this initial state. And I want to relax it. Well, we already encounter a beautiful open problem of the theory. So, are you getting down the screen, or how do we do this?
Just pull it down.
We don't do that, sorry. Oh, it's here. Well, let's go to the next picture.
Just to show it also.
Everybody on YouTube, the camera really makes you fatter, you know? Anyway, so.
Yeah, it's the
guy. Let's move. Actually, this is my last picture. I'm going to use this, but later. Let's just move more. And the previous ones?
Actually, this is
the one. Oh, it didn't go through? Huh? It didn't go through?
I have only this.
Well, that's too bad. My screen showed. But it doesn't matter. We can. We can try to rule it up. If you can rule it up. Yes. Just write some by Google. And we'll go to images in Google.
Sand part.
Mobile. Otherwise, you'll get actual sand. Yeah, this one. That's it. No, that one. Or, yeah, that one is, look at that one. You could make it big. But not that one. That one. That's all there. That's it. This is the black state. And now this is very possible. You see? We have this extremely simple local rule. We know it takes a unique final state to this dynamical process. And we get this fractal. What is going on? And explain this phenomenon and the mathematical structure of this fractal is an open problem. There is remarkable work by a remarkable mathematician that have proved parts of this. Has been proved that this is a weak star limit that has been proved. It has been proved that that appeared in Duke. It has been proved that there is this Apollonian circle structure. You see kind of this Apollonian circle, yes, is there, and this has been proved. But even the existence in the, not the weakest argument, in a sensible, in a more weakest argument of the straw is the fractal, in another convergence, ways of convergence, even the existence of the object is not proved. And much less a lot of the features you see, you just see them, the computer sees them. Just like with the Mandelbrot set, you see the Mandelbrot set. It took a long time for people in dynamical systems to prove many of these properties that you were seeing in the Mandelbrot set. Where the early stage here, people had worked on Santa for 30 years only, and in 30 years, this picture has not been explained. But now I can tell you what it has to do with self-organized criticality and power loss. But already, it's self-organized. Nobody programmed the computer to draw this picture, this fractal. It's not like these programs that you do on the computer with the express purpose of drawing a fractal. You had no intention, you just relax in this state. Probably this is much smaller because of the resolution. But as these numbers grow and the size of the table grows, take the square root of the size of the table. It's lost. There is this so-called scaling limit. And the existence of the scaling limit has not proved. But say you have the scaling limit, and it's there. It's the same, as you define it. It's this one. There. And now you put one grain of sand, and you put it at random, uniformly, anywhere. And you relax. But now you count the total sum, or an integral, the total sum of the toppling function for that grain of sand, one little grain of sand that it dropped. And it causes what it's called an avalanche. It does something. Your intuition is that it shouldn't do too much, you know, you just put a little grain of sand. And your intuition, it's okay, very often. Put a grain of sand, little avalanches, avalanches, avalanches. But then all of a sudden, you put a grain of sand just somewhere. There's this huge avalanche. And the whole picture is dramatically affected. And the statistics of these avalanches is the statistic of earthquakes on Earth. It's the same kind of statistics. And the statistic of avalanches of sand. And now that's where we're going to the realistic features of this model for sand, is that it does mimic the statistical behavior of large bodies of sand, but not the microscopic behavior of sand. So you move this and you get these avalanches of different sizes. And if you take the size of the avalanche as a proxy for its energy, and you count how many avalanches of a given log energy you have, log of the probability, you get a straight line. And this is so-called a power law. And this is the kind of statistical law, very fat-tailed statistical law that you get in phase transition thermodynamics. This system that I just described already behaves like a phase system in phase transition in thermodynamics, but with tuned nothing, it organizes itself. And whenever you try to perturb it, it goes back to a self-organized critical state. So you get that this is statistics, and this is a test that you are in this criticality, and self-organized criticality hence. I covered 10% of my first lecture, but it was fun. Thank you very much.
Sorry,
I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm s talks. But let me say something. Now, you gave me a pretext to steal my minutes. This is really a manifestation, in a way of speaking, of the Riemann-Roch theory. So let me explain that. So, there is a variation of this game, the Stanford game, called the dollar game, that economists think about. So now you have a graph. But you think of the different people in the graph as people, or as economic agents. As economic agents, you think of them as economic agents. And now you think of the number here as the number of dollars they have. $7 million, $5 million, $2 million, minus $1 million, $0 billion. You think of as the number of dollars they have. And now you play the game. And the game is that you fire, it lends money to the neighbors. So this person lends money to this, to this, to this. And people cannot quite borrow, they can lend to the neighbors. And now you want to find the appropriate set of firings so that nobody owes money to anyone else. Is this possible? This is called the dollar game. It's very related, you can see it's very late. It's a sample, but with negative numbers, no sync. Negative and positive numbers, okay? So, let me just say very, very quickly that, so you have that. And now let me just say very quickly. You have this dollar game, when we say that two economic states, we say that an economic state on a graph, an economic state of a graph is called a divisor on the graph. So it's just called like that for no good reason, just a funny name, just called a divisor on the graph. Just the amount of money that everybody has, is just called a divisor on the graph. And now you say, well, two states are linearly equivalent if one is obtained to the other through this game. And you want to, and you solve the problem when you get into an effective state. It's called effective for some reason nobody knows, when it's everything is positive or zero. Then it's called an effective economic state, an effective divisor. And so you have linearly equivalent economic states, and you have the effective economic states. We should describe that E, the effective ones. There are states like states in the sample, the positive, now the positive ones. Of course, you can describe the Picard as the divisors, Monroe equivalence, and the Jacobian, you can describe it as divisors zero, of total degree. 0 degrees just the total sum of the economical state, modulo equivalence, of course. And you can talk about these as the effective ones that are equivalent. The effective ones that are equivalent, you can call this, for some weird reason that economists cannot really understand, but some people call them linear systems, who knows why. Anyway, but they are all the good economic states where everything is positive. And you can prove that the cardinality of the Jacobian is just the determinant of the Laplacian. This is a beautiful thing, and it's the same as the number of different bases that you can take for certain thing called the cohomology. And in any case, you define something called R of E, is minus one, if and only if there is no solutions to the dollar game. If and only if there is no solution to the dollar game. And now you can say R of D is bigger than or equal to K, if and only if D minus economic minus a positive state is not empty for every state with amount, this at least this amount, total amount of money in the economy. And so you define this R of D, and then you can prove a theorem, very useful in economics, of course. And For some reason, the economists cannot possibly consider. Some people call this theorem the Riemann-Roch theorem. Here, K is the economical state that everybody has a pole of order 2. Sorry, as many dollars as the degree minus 2. And G is the number of relations minus the number of economic agents plus 1. And so there is this theorem in economy. Some people call it the Riemann-Roch theorem. So this theory this is a fascinating and mysterious story. And we don't understand it very well. Because while in geometry one has sheaf cohomology, in economics one doesn't have homological algebra. And nobody has been able to implement it. And this is very mysterious. What is this thing that should be there but nobody has seen? Where is the homological algebra? But those are mysteries that will be explored in the book version of this talk. By the book, nice. Tomorrow, I will. But you see, we're getting into these features of complex systems. The interesting part of these economic systems is when it's huge, not when it's small. And so, what these economists have been doing is studying behavior that mathematicians and physicists have missed when the Riemann surfaces are of extremely large genus. What happens when Riemann surfaces, they behave differently. There's new phenomena. And this picture that we saw this could be construed as an extremely complicated state in an unbelievably large Riemann surface. More tomorrow.
Other questions?
Yeah. Well, having a graph with no sinks, is there an easy way, given an initial construction, to determine whether it will end after a finite number of firings or not?
It's like determining here whether you will get into a state that you want. And there is this algorithm in computer science for this. But of course, there is the Berman Forest algorithm, and there is algorithms. So there is algorithms in computer science that solve this problem.
Efficiently.
I'm not so sure. I think they are as good as it gets, but I'm not so sure.
Do you have reference for the Riemann-Roch theorem?
This is a classical paper, and I should know the authors. And I'm terribly embarrassed that I'm a Baker and someone else. And it's called the Riemann-Roch theorem in graphs.
Okay.
And it's a classical paper. And it has to do with an old remark of Giancarlo Rota. I can tell the story. Giancarlo Rota had this intuition that there was this geometry that was purely combinatorial.
And this is pre-tropical geometry.
Pre-tropical. He had this intuition that there should be this geometry, it should be about combinatorics, not about geometry. And in many ways, this is a very positive story, because this is the correct theorem of tropical geometry, as Grisha Michalkin has proved. This is the correct Riemann-Roch theorem. But you have to modify it a little. But no geometric proof is known. You have to do these combinatorics proofs. And so you would want a geometric proof. And of course, if it comes from a tropical degeneration, you would say I have a geometric proof. The problem is, not every graph comes from a tropical degeneration. Of course, it's very mysterious that to get the full Riemann-Roch theorem in tropical geometry, you need these combinatorics. But it's even more mysterious that there is no fusible Riemann-Roch in tropical geometry. We all think it's there, but... And because we don't have the usual apparatus, although Grisha and Lumin, they have this unbelievable paper where they do this tropical homology and all this story, and this is as good as it gets, we don't really have all the apparatus of homological algebra and categories and all this story. And so, this remains conjecture that should be there, but the specific form could be very subtle, and it's inaccessible right now. It's very hard, even in dimension two. And of course, this would produce much more realistic models, both in economics and in communication theory and in many other fields of undertaking, and it's missing.
In when you speak about thermodynamical interpretation, in thermodynamics we have something called thermodynamical limit, and after this limit we see phase transitions and
okay.
So here, do you have such a limit, perhaps this capital M?
It's called the scaling limit. And if you're a physicist, you believe it exists. But the mathematicians have not been able to, and there is remarkable papers, as I mentioned, there is a remarkable paper, but still, mathematicians have not really been able to produce a sensible argument. There is this very provoking paper by Muñoz and Viafara in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, and his collaborator, Moritz Lang, where they do a great step into the both introduction of homological algebra and the search for a scaling limit. But they change the question. They produce a state that they can control to get kind of a limit rather than proving that this one has a limit. So, but it's already a remarkable progress from Shkolnikov and Lang. But it's a very active and interesting field of mathematics.
All right, let's thank you, Ernesto.